any interruption, so you won't miss.
Oh, and then always somebody spots you and says, oh, you're so-and-so. And you think, oh, why did I do that? Why didn't I take the time to dress properly and look properly? And that's what you lose.
Another thing that always worked for you was that wonderful Irish brogue, right? You didn't lose that.
Well, you know, I think that basically the accent in the United States of America came from the Irish immigrants, if you really listen to it. And then, of course, it got a little touch of German and a little touch of French and a little touch of Spanish and everything.
It's a wonderful lyrical sound.
Yes.
We'll be right back with Maureen O'Hara. We'll talk about how she selects her roles. We'll talk about the one you're going to see Sunday night, other television movies she's done as well, actors she's worked with. Don't go away.
Why would you start to kill? Are you a man or a saint?
I am no saint. But I have a duty towards you. Let me do it.
She worked a lot for John Ford, including How Green Was My Valley, of course, and The Quiet Man. She also did The Long Gray Line. That was that great West Point movie with Tyrone Power.
Yeah.
One of my favorite all-time movies. Rio Grande, The Wings of Eagles. By the way, do you have children?
I have one daughter.
How old?
She's now in her 40s.
And what does she do?
She writes music and lyrics. She teaches Spanish. And she's a bookkeeper, too. She's a very fine, fine young lady and very beautiful.
As beautiful as you were, talented as you were, did you have relationships with any of your leading men?
No.
Never?
No.
You work with some pretty...
I worked... But everybody asks me, did I have a relationship with John Wayne? No.
Well, it's natural to assume, because they associate the two of you together so much.
Oh, I used to have an old lady stop me in the street and say, well, I saw all your children today. And they were all Duke's kids.
Back to Duke. What was special about him? You mentioned his lust. He was very political, right? Very opinionated on things.
Yes.
Loyal.
His greatest fault was his loyalty to people.
Too loyal.
He was too loyal. He was loyal to a fault. But he was a wonderful person.
He was
a great friend of my husband's, Charlie Blair's. And they used to play chess together all the time. And you'd say, what would you like for dinner? Steak. Well, what do you want with it? Potatoes.
And he was so huge, John Wayne.
Yes.
You know, so larger than life. How good an actor was he?
Well, you don't become the number one star and the number one favorite person of the entire world unless you're damn good. People, you can't fool people. And he couldn't have fooled not just people, he couldn't have fooled the whole world if he wasn't a fine actor.
And he was.
He was.
Okay. Tyrone Power.
A wonderful, wonderful performer. I loved him very much.
Died suddenly, didn't he? Heart attack?
Heart attack while fencing.
What was he, 40-something?
Something like that. It was very, very tragic.
Handsome.
Super handsome.
Too handsome.
And Irish, too.
And Irish, too. Saw him on Broadway in John Brown's Buddy.
Yeah. He was a great, great friend of mine. And when we first worked together, I was very young, and I didn't know little off-color stories. I really didn't know what they meant. And he used to say to me, let me tell you a story, and go tell it to the director. He'll love it. And me, like a fool, I would do it.
You worked frequently with Anthony Quinn. In fact, your last feature film, although you've done two television movies since,
great
Only the
friend.
Lonely with Quinn.
Yeah, great friend.
And we were talking before we started about John Candy.
Yeah.
And you thought he was a great actor.
I thought John Candy didn't realize how really fine and good of an actor he was. And if God had spared him, he would now be, hopefully, remaking all of the wonderful Lawton movies from the great movies that
Witness
he made.
For the Prosecution.
Wasn't that wonderful?
Tyrone Power,
yes,
Marlene
Dietrich. Yeah.
John Candy was underrated as an actor, but a beautiful person, wasn't he?
Beautiful person, And really, when he had his 40th birthday, I was with him, and Rose, his wife, and all, and his two kids. And he was being very grumpy. And I said, what in God's name are you being grumpy about? This is your birthday. And he said, Maureen, I'm on borrowed time. Everybody, all the men in my family have had heart problems around my age now. So I'll probably have a few more years, but not much more.
You think it was genes? You just didn't
genes,
hurry up.
Yeah.
We'll be right back with the wonderful Maureen O'Hara. You'll see her Sunday night in The Last Dance. We're going to ask about that and other things. Don't go away.
Ma! I'm an old woman. I can't be expected to wait on you hand and foot for the rest of my life. I'm sick and tired of doing your laundry, ironing your shirts, cooking your meals. I've lost gallons of sweat and buckets of blood. All for you. You've been nothing but a ball and chain of heartache and hurt hanging around my neck for too many godforsaken years. It'll be good riddance to you.
We're back with Maureen O'Hara. A couple of other people you've worked with, Anthony Quinn.
Yes.
Maybe the most with him, right? Five movies?
No, I made five with John Wayne, three with Jimmy Stewart, five with John Payne, three with Tyrone Power, three with Brian Keith, and it goes on.
Brian Keith, a suicide, hard to believe.
I don't believe it. No way. Brian and I had an appointment with his new parish priest the following week because I had gone over to have lunch with him, and he told me about this wonderful new priest, and oh, it was, and great stories, and he's dying for the two of us to get together and just chat and chat and chat. And I said, fine, okay. And when I left dinner that night, we were supposed to get together the following week. Now, I have to say something. He was in agony. From cancer. And he'd sit and be talking to you, and suddenly he'd go like this. And you knew he couldn't stand the pain. It was terrible. And he was in a wheelchair. Also, he was a gun nut. He loved guns and rifles and everything. And I believe... I think it was an accident. I really do. And there was nobody... nobody could defend him.
Was he too religious to kill himself?
Yes.
That could be a reason.
Yes.
Catholics.
And he could have been cleaning one, sitting in the wheelchair, cleaning one of these guns that he loved like babies, and had a spasm attack of agony, and the gun went off. I don't believe he did. I don't think God believes it either.
You're a believing person, obviously.
Yes.
Quinn had a great zest for living, has a great zest for living as well, right?
He has about 14 kids.
And he marinates a role, as Jackie Gleason once said, right? Yeah. What was it like working with him? Because he is a perfectionist.
Yes, he is a perfectionist. He's also a loud, noisy Mexican from Chihuahua. But did you know his father was from Ireland?
Everything comes back to the Irish with you.
Of course.
By the end of the show,
does.
I'm going to be Irish.
Yeah, we might baptize you and make you Irish. But his father was a cameraman in the west of Ireland. And he always said he was going to write the book about it. And his father came to the United States of America, migrated across the United States, taking photographs. He was a cameraman, and drifted down into Chihuahua and met Tony's mother, a Mexican Indian lady,
and fell in love with her. Quinn is an Irish name.
Yes, Quinn is an Irish name. Did you ever think of that?
No, in all the years I know him and have interviewed him, and I think of him as Mexican, and he acts like a Mexican, you know, and he has that...
Well, he acts a little bit like a fisherman from the Aran Islands. They're the same.
But now I think of it, Quinn is his name, yes.
Quinn.
That's Irish. So Jimmy Stewart, what was he like to work with?
A quiet, gentle, very nice man. If he was doing a scene and he didn't quite like what he was doing, he would stumble and stutter and stop so that he'd get to do it again. It was wonderful working with him.
So that was a gimmicky thing then? He could use that?
A little bit. He used it. We all have gimmicks we use. I'm sure you do.
Little tricks of the trade.
Little tricks of the trade. But he was a charming, wonderful man, adored his daughters. And when I first worked with him, the first couple of days he was a little, you know, he had to feel his way and find out what I was like. And then he started coming to me and saying, would you like to see these photographs I had taken in Africa when I was there on safari? And let me tell you. And I thought, he's trying to make up to me.
So he stopped living when his wife died, don't you
yes,
think?
Yes, yes. It absolutely destroyed him.
Our guest is the wonderful Maureen O'Hara. We're only halfway through. Ronald Reagan once said of Maureen O'Hara, her spirit, charm, and beauty have given everyone a glimpse of some of the Irish people's most special qualities. We'll be right back. Don't go away.
Boom! Now stop this at once. This is too much. Drop that gun! How dare you hit that man?
He's gonna shoot me.
Now, really, Mr. Burnett, you have a predisposition to violence of which I heartily disapprove.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, let's be on our way before you cause more trouble.
Yes, ma'am.
Come along, Hillary.
Yes, ma'am.
Wrap up your financial news day with Willow Bay and Stuart Varney. The Moneyline News Hour, weeknights, 6:30 Eastern on CNN.
Kramer, the magical donkey, opens the door to tremendous Toyota savings. 9 times out of 10, we can sell you a new Toyota for less because we have no mortgages and we pay cash for our new Toyotas, saving thousands of dollars in wholesale finance charges. So come online to BuckToyota.com on the AutoMile, Route 1 in Norwood, and get yourself a new Toyota today. My name's Ernie Buck. Come on down.
It's the biggest year-end closeout ever at Showcase Isuzu. Hey, folks, Town Park on Route 28 in Bourne. We're now through the 2nd of January. Prices will never be lower. In fact, you could save $5,000 on every brand-new Isuzu V-Across. Or every remaining 2,000 4x4 Trooper, save $8,000. But the key is you need to act now. Prices will never be lower again. 50, 75, 100 miles away is not too far. See why we say if it doesn't say Showcase, you definitely paid too much.
Step into the crossfire, weeknight, 7:30 Eastern on CNN.
All right, we will see you tomorrow night in The Last Dance on CBS.
That's right, that's right.
A television movie. And you've done two other television movies since your last feature film.
Yes, I did The Christmas Box, and we were number one in our time slot three times. And then we did Cab to Canada, and again, we were number one in our time slot. And when I say we, the we includes our producer, Beth Polson, one of the finest people
in
the television.
And is this her work, Sunday Night?
All of it is her work.
What is The Last Dance about?
It's about an old Latin teacher, sick, has a heart problem, goes into the hospital, meets a young man and realizes he was one of her Latin students. She was a Latin teacher. I'm her.
Mm-hmm.
And the last dance was the dance she was deprived of with her husband, who was killed in a snowstorm. And she has always lived hoping to have the last dance.
It is a romantic, sentimental...
It's a very sentimental. And if you look
bring
at it...
Bring handkerchiefs.
Bring a box of Kleenex to hell with a handkerchief. A handkerchief isn't enough. You'll really weep and hopefully love it and all the stories it has to tell. And particularly how today we don't pay school teachers the honor and respect they should have, because school teachers half raise the children of the world. The parents raise the other half.
We can make a case that a most important profession, certainly the most underpaid.
A good teacher's worth a fortune.
When you approach this kind of role, what do you think about it a lot, or are you instinctive? How do you deal with it?
No, you do think about it a lot. Then you walk away from it and turn your back on your thoughts, and then you start tearing it apart in bits and pieces and start writing notes to yourself. Remember in scene so-and-so, and so you're going to do so-and-so, so set it up now. You do. You write every page of your script is full of little notes. And I used to do mine in shorthand so nobody'd know what I was up to.
You know shorthand, then?
Pittman's.
Ah.
Which is very old-fashioned. Nobody does that now.
You are 80?
Yes.
Do you feel 80?
No. Not one second. I think my mother gave me the wrong birth date. I really do.
You don't look it.
I don't feel it.
Is this woman supposed to be 80 in The Last Dance? Or is that...
No, just ancient.
Ancient. So, isn't it hard to get scripts?
Yes. For all of the people that I grew up with in the motion picture industry, the female stars, it's very difficult to get scripts. Some of the female stars I've worked with, I get shocked with them. I want to take a whip and wallop them.
What do you mean?
Because they've let themselves go. You don't do that.
You mean let themselves what?
Get fat. Yeah, you don't
do
that.
You're not going to name names, are you?
No, no way.
But you get mad that they... Well, yes. Don't you think it happens because they don't get scripts? And they get kind of down. And
Probably, so they eat a little.
And...
Well, you shouldn't get that down. There's always something you can go out and do. You can volunteer. And the one thing necessary today is people who are old and have retired and have nothing to do, why don't they go out and offer their time and teach the children today to read and write? It is so important because all this computer stuff, children are not learning like they used to learn.
Handy aids.
Yes.
Do you, now you live in St. Croix. And Ireland.
Yes.
And here?
I visit here for my physicals and, of course, to work with Beth Polson, which is an honor. And I hope she enjoys working with me. She
well,
must, or she wouldn't hire
three
me
times.
Three times.
Yeah.
And there's a new script ready. We're going
another
to
see another
television
movie.
Yeah. And I don't die.
Will you do a feature movie again?
Yes, if there was a great script.
Why St. Croix?
Because that's where Charlie Blair moved and lived to when he retired from the Air Force and from Pan Am.
That was a happy marriage.
Absolutely heaven.
How many years?
Only 10.
But worth it.
Oh, boy. Worth everything. But I had known him from about 1947. We had been family friends. My brother met him when he did his the fastest flight to London, which a record still stands. Nobody's ever tried to break it. And when he went over the pole, and...
He was adventuresome, as is his wife.
Yeah.
And Ireland, you still go home to Ireland?
Yes, I go in June and stay until October. I just came back, and I go in June because the end of June, I have my golf tournament. It's the General Charles F. Blair golf tournament and the Maureen O'Hara Blair golf tournament. And one is for men and one is for ladies. And we're sponsored by Murphy Stout.
The beer.
The beer.
We'll be right back with Maureen O'Hara. She just got an incredible award from the Heartland Film Festival. That and more after this.
Todd used to take me rock climbing.
What?
And? Oh, now we're lucky if we have a cup of coffee together.
Yes, because now we have a lot of responsibilities.
What about fun?
Well, that'll come. That'll come later. Right now we're saving up for the future.
And what about the present?
Well, mostly I think about the mortgage, college funds for the kids, car payments, you know, the usual.
Do you mean to tell me that in your old age, you and Denise are going to reminisce about bills?
I want to ask about another actor before we talk about this award and some other things. Henry Fonda.
Heaven to work with.
Hank, as his friends call him.
Perhaps one of the finest actors in the world and a gentleman, a wonderful, wonderful person. And if you had a very sad scene or a very dramatic scene you had to do, all you had to do was look at his eyes and that you were finished. You did a wonderful scene. That's the relationship between two performers. If you give to each other, you both have to be wonderful.
Yeah.
But if you steal from each other, you both stink.
Great acting, as Al Pacino says, is giving.
Yes,
right? The great actor gives.
Yes.
The good actor or the poor actor doesn't. and you see it. The audience sees it. With Jimmy Stewart, you did The Rare Breed.
Rare Breed, and Mr. Hobbs Takes a Vacation.
I love that movie. Yeah. And you did The Parent Trap with Brian Keith. Funny.
And he was also in The Rare Breed.
And you did Against All Flags with Anthony Quinn.
Errol Flynn.
Now, don't tell me he didn't try to date you.
No.
Errol Flynn?
No. No way. You've got to realize...
He dated wallpaper. No, I'm sorry.
Thank you very much.
No, you're so beautiful. Why wouldn't he? Errol Flynn. He was nice.
He didn't have a very good reputation, but he never came to the set without knowing his dialogue, without being prepared to do his job. And I don't think I'm hurting his reputation or being mean about him, but by 4 o'clock in the afternoon...
Gone.
And so he was let go home. And many of your great love scenes where you say, I love you, was to a white chalk mark on a black cloth.
You drank all day?
Yeah, it was very sad.
You also...
He was Irish too, you know. Australian Irish.
You appeared in a movie that's legendary. Miracle on
34th Street. Yes.
With the Edmund Gwenn, right?
Oh, there was
Santa.
A sweetheart. We loved him so much, by the end of the movie, we really believed he was Santa.
And that was with John Payne,
wonderful
actor. Wonderful.
Made five with John Payne.
They don't talk about him enough. You know, he's kind of been forgotten.
Well, he was in that terrible accident in New York, and he retired. And he became a professor of English at the big university here. He gave up movies because of the accident in New York.
Did you know Miracle on 34th Street would be the kind of hit it was and become legendary?
Well, we knew it was going to be a hit. It had so much heart, it had to. But we didn't realize it was going to be a what is it now? Almost 60 years.
1947.
47, 57, 67, 77, 87, 97.
53 years.
Do you realize that next year will be 50 years since we made The Quiet Man? Time flies, you know.
You were doing interviews when you were 14, right?
Yes.
You were hosting a show.
Yes. Very well paid, too.
What did you make?
£1 a week. At that time, I think it was worth $3.
Do you still get the same kick out of acting?
Yes.
It's still as much fun as when you worked with Lawton.
And when you do a good scene, you're so thrilled and so excited, and it's so wonderful. Like, for instance, in The Last Dance, Eric Stoltz used to always tease about why was I number one on the call sheet. Mm-hmm. It was number one, Maureen O'Hara, number two, yeah, Eric Stoltz. And he made a fuss over it. And every day the crew loved it and waited for him to start making this fuss was I number one? Why was he number two? And then we did the scene in the hospital where they brought all of the people who had been in school and everything else to see her before she died instead of after she died. And when I did the scene, Eric stood up and he said, now, he said, now you know why she's number one. And that, I don't care who you are, if you say you weren't thrilled, you're a liar. You're pretending
you don't
have an ego. I was thrilled.
Back with more of Maureen O'Hara right after this. Maureen O'Hara received the she got the Heartland Film Festival Award, the Career Achievement Award, for the integrity of her work. And it said to recognize and honor filmmakers whose work explored the human journey by artistically expressing hope and respect for the positive values of life. Nice to get that.
Yes. But I must say that all my leading men, and you know, 90% of them are dead now, which is very sad. But they never wanted to do anything in a movie that was out of line, was not in good taste, that the good man didn't win, even if we had one heck of a fight getting to that point, which was always wonderful. Some of the movies had the greatest fights in the world. And I felt the same way. And perhaps to illustrate something that when we were making McClintock, I had to wear a corselet and these awful bloomers with lace on the bottom of them. And I thought, oh, they're just so awful. And I thought, I don't have bad-looking legs. Why can't I show them and shorten those pants a little bit? So I went to Duke, and because Duke was always the boss. And I said, Duke, please, can't I shorten these? And he turned on me, he said, Maureen, we make family pictures, not things we're ashamed of. No, you wear those pants in the proper length. So I did.
What do you go to movies today?
I don't have time. I have too much to do, and I'd like to live 22 more years, at least.
You want to be 102?
Two.
Why? Why that particular?
Well, my mother-in-law, Charlie Blair's mother, lived to be 102, and she was the oldest scout mistress in the United States of America. Also, she was Irish, of course. But she was a wonderful, tough, tough old gal. I thought she was terrific. And I thought, by God, I'd like to be a tough old gal and be 102 and carry a stick and thump it on the ground at all the kids. I'd love it.
Are you in good health?
Yes, thank God. Yes. Thank
God.
And
you keep back. All right. What was it like? I mean, Charlie Blair was incredible.
He was.
Died in a plane crash.
Yes.
To hear that. I mean, it's one thing to die. But one wondering to hear how you die.
Well, I was hysterical when I heard about it, and I called Charlie's Grandma Blair, Charlie's mother, and she said to me on the phone, she said, stop that nonsense. He died the way he would have wanted to.
And that worked?
Yeah, it did.
And you became president of an airline, didn't you?
Yes, I was the first woman in the United States of America to be an elected president of a scheduled airline.
Which was what airline?
Antilles Airlines in the Caribbean. It was called Antilles Airboats. They were all seaplanes. We had 26 planes, we had 23 pilots, and I loved every minute of it. The only thing that happened once in a while, dealing with men, you suddenly heard words coming out of your mouth that were not ladylike. And I thought, this is not a woman's job. So Charlie had already started negotiations to sell the airline, and I decided to go through with it. So I didn't have to start swearing in my old age.
Where did his plane crash?
Outside of St. Thomas.
Was it one of his own aircraft?
Yes, yes.
We'll be back with our remaining moments with Maureen O'Hara. She stars in The Last Dance. You'll see it on CBS tomorrow night. Bring the Kleenex. Okay, your goal is to live to 102.
Two.
What's your immediate goal? You're going to do another film?
I'm doing another film with Beth Polson, producer Beth Polson, and the script is all ready.
You shoot out here?
I don't know. That's up to her.
You ever turn down a role you regretted?
I missed roles that I really regretted.
Like?
Harry Cohen was going to buy My Fair Lady for me. And,
no kidding.
Yes, and a big company started bidding against him.
Oh.
And he sent for me one day and he said, Maureen, I'm sorry.
Columbia, right?
Yeah, a wonderful man. If you want
to. You
a story,
were the one that liked him?
I loved
Why
him.
Why did he tell jokes about people hating him?
He liked probably to cover up his soft heart. I'll
Boy,
tell you,
so
if you have time, I'll tell you a fabulous story about Harry Cohen. I have told many
minutes.
People and they have never, ever printed it or done anything about it. I was under part contract with Columbia, and I got on very well with Harry Cohen, and he used to say, she's the only dame that has the guts to come in and sit down and look at me and talk to me. But anyway, I did, because I liked him. And I got a call one day from his secretary that I was to come in and see him that afternoon, and I thought, oh my God, what have I done now? What, I'm going to get hell for something. So I went in, and he always gave me a kiss on both cheeks, and he did, and he said, sit down, I want you to stay with me this afternoon. And I thought, stay with him, what for? And he said, Maureen, you're the only person I know who understands Judaism and Catholicism. And he said, I know your whole background, I've learned everything about you. I know that your family was in the clothing business. You were Christians in the clothing business. I know your mother was a singer, and I went through it. My father was a sportsman, soccer. And he said, my boys and my wife are becoming Catholics this afternoon. would you stay with me? Well, every minute he was looking at the watch, looking at the watch. And then the tears started to roll down his cheeks. This tough old boy, softy.
And what a story. They converted.
They converted. And then suddenly he looked at his watch and he said, all right, you can go now. And I got up and he gave me a big hug and a kiss on each cheek. And he said, thank you. Goodbye.
What a when 3,200 people came to his funeral and someone asked George Jessel if he wasn't well liked, why did so many people come? And he said, give the public what it wants and they'll show up.
But he was a wonderful, kind man, but he was a tough, tough businessman. But so, that's what he was supposed to be.
So had he bought My Fair Lady, had he won the bidding, you'd have been Eliza Doolittle.
Yeah. And the other terrible disappointment in my life was Daryl Zanuck cast me in Anna and the King as I Am. Because I sing, or I did sing. And Lou Schreiber was second in command at 20th Century Fox. And Lou called me from the airport and he said, Maureen, I'm going into New York with your recordings to tie up the deal. Wish me luck, because I have to see Rodgers and Hammerstein. He went into New York, he saw Rodgers and Hammerstein, and he said, Daryl Zanuck wants her to play Anna. And they said, what? A pirate queen play our Anna? Never. And I didn't get to do it.
The King and I.
The King and I. But years later, I told them how I would have played it. And they asked me, would I do it on Broadway in a revival? And I said, you turn me down once, you don't get a second chance.
Yada. You're
That's
tough.
That's me. No, I've got integrity.
Well, why didn't you sing more in movies? You never got musicals, right?
No.
But you did play Pirate Queens.
Yeah. And I loved it.
Swashbuckling.
I outfenced Errol Flynn. I was proficient with the sword. I was a fine talent with a bullwhip. I could take a cigarette out of your mouth and toss it in the air and catch it.
Would you go back to Broadway with the right play?
I'm too old. That's the only time, I'll admit. Because I don't think I could do it every night in two matinees.
Thank you, darling.
You're very welcome.
Maureen O'Hara. Need we say more? She's a very young 80. It's going to make it to 102. She'll make it to 102. And you'll see her tomorrow night in The Last Dance on CBS. Monday night, more of Election 2000. We're only going to be, she's 10 days away today from electing a president. Thanks for joining us, and good night.